Tommaso, who will be speaking about rationally inattentive preferences? Please, Tommaso.
Argument, we provide an axiomatic foundation for a model of rational, for a model of choice. It's not working.
Let me repeat the confusing statement. So in this paper, using a reveal preference argument, we provide an axiomatic foundation for a model of choice under rational inattention. And so my goal today is to explain to you this statement. Hopefully, I will succeed. So the presentation, the core of the presentation is 20 minutes, should last 20 minutes, so please ask question if something is not clear and interrupt me. Okay, so models of choice under rational inattention are now widely used in economics in order to analyze the implications of the hypothesis that agents are rational inattentive. So let's start by stating the rational inattention hypothesis. Agents need information to make better choices. However, getting information requires attention, and attention is a costly resource. So, agents optimally allocate their attention to get the information they need most. Bottom line, there is a trade-off between value and cost of information. So, first remark, the inattention is in the fact that attention is costly, while the rationality lies in the fact that attention is optimally allocated. Second remark, why attention is costly? So we can think of the time and effort needed to process information, or you can also consider some bounded rationality concern about the ability of the information to process information. Actually, in this paper, we are agnostic about why attention is costly. We will simply assume that. So, the idea that economic agents are rational inattentive has long been debated in economics. Here is a light literature review that I won't cover, except for this 2003 breakthrough paper by Chris Sims. So, in this 2003 paper, Sims does two things. So, first, he uses the tools of information theory to model rational inattention, therefore providing a tractable framework to think about inattention in economics. And second, he convincingly argues that rational inattention has relevant implications for economics. For instance, in the context of macroeconomics, think of an economy populated by rational inattentive agents. If there is a shock to the economy, that the agents being rational inattentive imperfectly, partially observe the shock. As a consequence, they imperfectly, smoothly react to it, and therefore macroeconomic variables, at least endogenous macroeconomic variables, sluggishly respond to the shock. Which is what we see in the data. Think, for instance, of the literature on sticky prices. So, this applied literature on rational inattention raises at least four interesting theoretical questions. Well, interesting at least in our opinion. So, is information theory the right way to think about inattention? Is it possible to falsify the rational inattention hypothesis? How to calibrate models of choice under rational inattention? When we can say that an agent is more attentive than another agent? So in this paper, we try to answer these questions by analyzing the following choice problem. Let me start with a verbal description. A decision maker, DM for short, chooses today among sets of alternatives. The sets are called menus, and the alternatives are called acts. Tomorrow, the DM will select an act from the menu chosen today. The outcome of the selected act will depend on the state of the world. Today, the DM does not know which is the state of the world. Nevertheless, after the choice among menus, she can get some information to reduce the uncertainty and improve her choice from the menu. So to clarify, let's see graphically, this is the order of events. So first we have the choice of a menu, then we have the allocation of attention, and finally from the selected menu, an act is chosen, contingent on the new information acquired about the state of the world, acquired by allocating attention. Is this choice problem clear enough? Okay. So, now, suppose the decision maker is rationally inattentive. How to model her behavior in this situation? So, in particular here, we are interested in how the DM ranks menus. Other work, such as Kaplan and Dean 2013 and Dallas 2012, they focus on how she ranks acts given a menu. And for a reference, let me say that this choice problem belongs to the broad family of menu choice problem initiated by Krebs in the 79. Now the literature is quite large. Okay. So, this menu choice problem may seem a little bit abstract, and the jargon does not help. However, it can be seen that the verbal description I previously gave fits many common dynamic choice problems. Indeed, at least in this paper, menus are just a way to formulate the idea that today's action affects the outcome of tomorrow's action. We will see maybe this here. Okay, so we have this verbal description, and now we start to formalize the problem. So, Omega is a finite set of states of the world representing the basic space of uncertainty. X is a convex set of outcomes. An act, lowercase f, is a map from states to outcomes. And uppercase f, a menu, is a finite set of acts. Now, using the language we learned yesterday, you recognize that a menu is just a set of Vansko-Bauman acts. Indeed, I say outcomes, but I could have said consequences, and the convexity of the set can be think of like X can be simple lotteries over a set of prices. And so, in particular, given the talk yesterday and using like the approach of Battigalli, Celeia Vioglio, Maccheroni and Marinacci, 2013, we can imagine a reformulation of this problem using a consequence function, as we did yesterday. So for instance, you can think of a consequence function and two sets of action. One action should be today's action, one set of action should contain today's action, and the second set of action should contain tomorrow's set of action, and of course the consequence function should also depend on the state. And morally, intuitively, today's action should correspond to a menu, and tomorrow's action should correspond to an act. Now, a side remark, here X is convex, and so recall the discussion we had yesterday about the randomization. Also here, in the formalization with the consequence function, you can imagine a randomization of the first set of action, a randomization of our menu, and you can imagine like a map from that setup to this setting with the sets of Vansko-Bauman act. And let me say just, I think that that kind of exercise can be interesting in this context because the convex nature of the set of X is very important in the menu choice literature and is not well understood its role and its meaning in this context. context, and I think that exercise can be fruitful. I even thought of like trying to do it today, but it was better to stick to the original presentation. So let's end this side remark connecting basically my talk today with the talk we had yesterday. And okay, let's get back to the formulation with the sets of Ansco-Bauman act. So the DM, before allocating attention, holds some prior beliefs about the state of the world, which are represented by a probability measure, p bar over omega. Moreover, there is also an affine utility function U mapping outcomes into real number representing DM's taste over outcomes. So you can think of like the last two object as the subjective object, while the menus are the act, are the exogenous object. Okay. Up to now, everything is basically standard. Now, following Sim's approach, we want to use the tools of information theory to model. So the most important object is a channel. A channel is a way to formalize the idea of an information source, of a source of information. So more formally, a channel is a probability distribution over posterior, such that the expected posterior is equal to the prior. In other words, a channel specifies the probability of obtaining a posterior P by updating prior P bar after the arrival of new information. Okay. Condition one is the so-called martingale property of posteriors, and it says, as I said before, that the expected information conveyed by the channel coincide with the prior information. Okay, we denote by this pi of p bar the set of channel corresponding to the prior p bar. And let me say that, so the term channel comes from information theory. In statistics and in economics, the same object is called experiment, basically. So it is clear why, okay? If you have any question, please interrupt me, like. Okay. Well, in the description I just gave you is the ex-ante belief about omega. In here it is subjective, like in another model, in a macroeconomic model, this is the distribution over the unknown state variable. Yeah, I already had this discussion. So, no, it's the same, because so if you want to try to map this setting into the usual Bayesian formulation, you should think of omega as theta, and basically the signal you receive is not formulated here, but coalesced in this object. So what is happening, you can think of like expanding this setup, where you have theta, which is omega, and you observe a signal about theta, and then you update. And so from the prior p bar on omega, you obtain a posterior, observing a signal and updating the prior. Here, the signal, since it's basically relevant, the alphabet you use for the signaling space, everything you need, at least in this setup, to make a choice, is ex ante, is the distribution over posterior you get, because
the
then...
When you mention the relationship with the yesterday's dog, consequences depend on omega, and I will tell you that omega is theta.
No, careful, because, so, you can, okay, I said that omega is theta, but then nothing is saying that omega is not observable. So you can think of like omega is the interest rate set by the Fed next week, and the observation is like some magazine you read. So it is true that when I'm trying to translate to you this setup into the Bayesian setting, I say theta, and theta usually is a parameter not observable. But the same framework can be used.
I care about observer, I'm not obsessed with these observability things. I care about theta parameterizes kind of objective probability models. The Bayesian framework, not it doesn't parameterize it.
Okay. And so what you are saying.
Don't waste your time.
No, but it's okay. No, but I think. No, I think I have understood what you say, and I think that omega is the same omega you have yesterday. Okay. So finally, we are ready to see. How the DM, who is Russian inattentive, ranks menu. So the value of a menu, VF, is given by the real number defined by this expression. So the only object I have not introduced so far is C, which is a map from channels into the non-negative part of the extended real line, and which is an information cost function. So let me explain to you this expression. Let me give you an interpretation from this expression. Let's go back briefly to the, So this expression can be seen as the result of a two-stage optimization problem. Let me go back to the timeline. So we have that, recall that we have given a menu, we have attention allocation, and then a choice of an act. So the first stage of the optimization problem is the allocation of attention, and the second stage of the optimization problem is the choice of an act. And now, keeping this in mind, it's going to be easy to understand this functional form. Indeed, proceeding backwardly, we start from the second stage. So the objective of the second stage is between round brackets, and it is to maximize expected utility for any given posterior by optimally choosing an act from the menu F. Then the objective of the first stage of the optimization problem is in square brackets. I hope I said round brackets before, because now it's square brackets. And it is to maximize the value of information, which is the first term of this sum, minus the cost of information, which is C of pi. And this is done by optimally choosing a channel, no? Maximizing pi in the set of channels. And so here again, the idea is that the subjective costs of paying attention are represented by C, by the information cost function, while the rationality component in the allocation of attention is represented by the optimal choice of a channel. Okay, so basically the idea is that this value function, this way to ranks menu, comes from the procedure that I just explained to you, right? So you choose an act given a posterior, then you choose a channel, and you take expectation over all posteriors. Okay. The parameter of this choice criterion are the utility function U, the prior P bar, and the information cost function C. Now, many specifications of the information cost functions have been used in the applied literature on Russian inattention. And most of them are based on the Shannon entropy, More importantly for our paper, that all of them, almost all of them, share the following properties. So C is weakly lower semi-continuous and convex. Then consider a channel which is concentrated on the prior, that is a channel that conveys no new information about the state of the world. Then it is assumed that this channel is costless. And finally, C is monotone with respect to the Blackwell order. What does it mean? It means that channels that are more informative, according to the standard Blackwell's definition of informativeness, given for experiment adapted for channel, channels that are more informative are also more expensive. And for convenience, let me remind you that according to Blackwell, channel pi is more informative than channel rho if the expected value of phi, calculated and computed under pi, is greater than the expected value of phi under rho for all continuous and convex function phi mapping posteriors into the real line. This is a standard definition. You need an intuition, or you're already familiar with this kind of... It is basically saying that pi is a sufficient statistic for rho in another formulation. It's okay. Now, observe that the displayed function mapping channels into the extended real line is concave and weakly upper semi-continuous. Now, as a consequence, the value of the menu, V of F, can be seen as the result of the maximization of a concave and weakly upper semi-continuous function, which is the dual problem to the most classical variational problem, which is the minimization of a convex and lower semi-continuous function. This observation is crucial for our paper because we know that in a different setting, Maccheroni, Marinaccia, Rustichini 2006 study preferences with a variational representation. As a consequence, adapting their methods to our setting, we can provide an axiomatic foundation for V, for the value function, which is the main contribution of this paper. To be more precise, these are the contribution of the paper. So we start from a preference relation, let me call it squiggle, on menus. This object, I realize now that this object has not yet been introduced. Yeah. 5 minutes? Ah, basically done. So let me remind you that I realize now that this object is not yet introduced in this today, so basically you may need to. So this is, so squiggle is a binary relation over the set of all menus, and a statement like F squiggle G should be read as F is preferred, weakly preferred to G. So this binary relation represents the preferences of the decision maker over the set of all menus. So basically imagine that you go to the decision maker with menu F and menu G, and you ask him, what do you want? You want F, you want G. If he picks F, then F is preferred to G, and you have this binary relation. Okay. So in this paper, we provide necessary and sufficient condition on squiggle such that the preference is represented by V for some choice of the parameters. Represented by V means that F is preferred to G if and only if V of F is weakly greater than V and G for all pair of menus. We call rational inattentive preferences the class of preferences satisfying these conditions, these axioms. And in the paper, the axioms are motivated exactly by the idea that the decision maker is rational and attentive. So the idea that he faces an abundance of information, which requires costly attention to select and process. And moreover, in the paper, we show that the parameters are uniquely identified and elicitable by observing preferences. And finally, we characterize behavioral measures of comparative inattention. So to conclude, basically, these are our answers to the questions I posed, to the four theoretical questions I posed before. So the first question was about is information theory the right way to think about inattention? Here we have a set of axioms motivated in terms of attention, and the representation, which is information theoretic. The second question was about the possibility of testing the rational attention hypothesis. And here we have axioms, which are falsifiable and are on observables. So you can go to data in a lab or in the real world and try to understand whether people satisfy this model. The third question was about is it possible to calibrate, how to calibrate models of rational inattention? And here we have parameters that are uniquely identified and more or less easily elicitable by observing choices. And finally, our proposal for a notion of comparative inattention. Okay, I think I'm done.
Thanks very much, Tommaso. Are there questions?
Can you just tell us a bit more about why we should or we could see the pie as an experiment? There is the slide in which you talk about Blackwell ordering, and I mean, in what sense should I see P as an experiment?
Okay.
So I'm making up my mind, if I'm not wrong, I'm making up my mind about the relative likelihood of the states so that I will choose F smartly, quotes and quotes smartly. So what does it mean that a pi over these models, P's, is
So first of all, this is a representation. So, okay. Second of all, we are more familiar with the idea of having two random variables, one which is an observable, at least ex ante, and the other which is observable. The second random variable is used as a signal, so it should signaling something you observe and then you update and you learn something about the first random variable. Here, you can think of the set of posteriors as the second random variable. And the signal says you should use posterior P. This is the intuition. So a signal usually is saying to you, like, saying to you A, B, C, and then you say, oh, this is A, then you have the relation between the two random variables, you update, and you draw your conclusion.
By the probability that the signal, after updating, doing all the blah, 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 will tell you use P.
It's a signaling structure for lazy people that don't want to update their prior. Please.
He decided. Shouldn't have had questions. Are there any questions?
Yeah. This is a question about the literature. What's the relationship between your representation and model and the Ergun Salva costly contemplation? I'm guessing you thought about it. I just have some hypotheses, but I kind of would like.
Yeah, I'm happy to have this question also here. Now, basically, so for the non-economists, this Ergun Salva paper is closely related to. Is related to our paper, and I have a reference here. So, in a couple of words. So, first, what they do. In Ergun and Sarver, they study, again, a menu choice, a choice problem involving menus, without states of the world. So, the menus are sets of lotteries. and the decision maker has some preferences over this set of lotteries, and their representation is basically motivated by the idea that when the decision maker chooses among menus, is not sure about his preferences over lotteries, over the object inside these menus, and so he has to exert costly contemplation to figure out which are these preferences. Now, a way to see this work is that this is a class of preferences that admit a costly representation. And basically they are, even if they are working in a setting with risk and we are working in a setting with uncertainty, one can think that rational inattention can be seen as a phenomenon of costly contemplation. So what we have here is basically with respect to their paper, here the contribution is that the information theoretic interpretation and the information theoretic structure is richer, way richer, in the sense that here we have the Blackwell order, here we have channels, here we have fixed posteriors. So the first thing to say is that even if, so in their paper they say that, you can see this functional representation as the result of an information acquisition problem. One of the issue with the interpretation of that representation is that, for instance, they have a cost function, and this cost function can be anything. There are no restrictions. So suppose I present you this work, and we have the cost function without any properties. You can have totally informative channels which are costless. You can have any order, and so I think, in my opinion, this information theoretic interpretation of the representation in their paper is weaker than what we have here. This is one of the many differences between the two works.
Okay, let's thank our speaker again.